were a bicoronal flap along with a subciliary incision on either side. They were able to go all the way down up to the maxilla. Total deglowing of the face and putting it back. So that is the reach of the subcoronal approach. Now, when you look at it, anatomically, there are a few things you have to understand. The one is the layers of the scalp. Layers of the scalp are different in three differences has to be noted in the layers of the scalp. One is in the main area of incision. It is the mnemonic scalp, like skin, subcutaneous tissue, upper neurosis, loose tissue, and periosteum, pericranium. In the area of the temporalis muscle area, below the, see, this, the ridge, temporal ridge from the superior orbital line up to this one, in this area, the other facial layers come into play. So here it would be skin. The aponeurosis is a superficial temporal fascia, is a different entity from the deep temporal fascia. So if you look at it, skin, subcutaneous tissue, aponeurosis, superficial temporal fascia itself has got about three to five layers. And the important structure within that would be the artery, superficial temporal artery, and the veins in between that. And the facial nerve branch also has got relationship to deep temporal fascia as well as superficial temporal fascia. So in this level, so you will have a multi-layered superficial temporal fascia and then the deep temporal fascia. Below that will be the temporalis muscle and then the bone. Below this level, when you reach the zygoma, you have the splitting of the deep temporal fascia also. Deep temporal fascia splits into two. It's not a superficial temporal fascia when split. So when you put the super, go along the superficial temporal fascia, it continues as this mass. When it comes to the deep temporal fascia, it divides into two, goes, hugs the, you know, covers the zygoma, and the superficial layer below that will be the temporal pad of fat. Within that will be the middle temporal, the artery. So you have immediately, if you incise that one, you will have a fat, then the artery. Artery is the content there, and then the muscle which goes down there. Okay, so that is the way. So sorry, fat, the other layer of fascia, and the muscle. Muscle will be going and then deep and hugging to the coronoid. The main problem here would be the nerve, the frontal branch of facial nerve. Superficial temporal artery and vein, frontal branch of facial nerve, and the artery within the temporal pad of fat. The artery within the temporal pad of fat is important, apparently, because if you damage it, there will be more of atrophy of the fat and there will be hollowness will be more. That is up. So that is why you have to be careful to be careful not to injure that. But more worrisome is the nerve. Nerve is between, if you look at the lateral canthus and the tragus, midpoint, here the nerve will traverse the deep, traverse through the superficial temporal fascia to the superficial, reaching a superficial nature. So if you elevate it, your elevation is always in the subgaleal plane, and the superficial temporal fascia also is stripped down. So if you just keep on doing like that, you will cut the nerve. So here in this line, you have to incise the deep temporal fascia and go down. Then you will be saving the nerve. The other point which you have to be, when you raise the flap, there are two ways of raising the flap. One is to raise with the pericranium. So you incise, go to the pericranium, just strip it down. The problem is that you cannot use the galeo-pericranial flap in that case. To dissect the galeo-pericranium from that elevated thing is extremely difficult. So if you are planning for a galeopericranial flap, you leave the pericranium in the body and raise it up. Both are easy, actually. Both are in a good plane, so it's not very difficult. So when you raise it, so you pre-plan it, and if you want to raise it like that, you just raise it and then delineate the pericranium and then lift it as a separate flap. Now, in your frontal sinus work, if you want to do a frontal sinus work, what you do is to go like this. You can go like this and then incise the pericranium and then lift it off. There. If you want to have a orbital work, you raise it like this and then incise the pericranium like this and then go down. Now, the main issue would be this bundle here, which can be separated from the, it can be lifted down so that your whole superior orbital rim is visualized. The roof can be visualized from inside. For that, you may just need to tap the bone here. If it comes through a canal, you have to use a tap to free it down so that it can go down. Here the procerus muscle will be there. Again, that will have to be detached and pushed down. But those are all very minor points. The trochlea and the supraorbital bundle is something which you will have to free if you are doing, especially in maxillofacial trauma, to get into the area. Now, from the craniofacial, subcranial approaches and the craniofacial cancer surgery point of view, the problem is that you take this bone out and then put it back. The patient has post-op RT, there's a chance that the bone can necrose. In those cases, you can use this as a pedicled sort of flap. You can raise the pericranium, raise it, and then just lift it up to the area of the cut, and then cut it across, and then make some tunnels there and cut it. Do a tapping to cut it, so that the whole bone comes with the vascularized fascia. So that is a bit tricky and it is a bit difficult to do. Classic way is to just lift it up and take the bone off and put it back. So again, the other things to the differences which has been described is that where to start and where to end. Usually it is a pre-tragal to pre-tragal there. And now the way it is designed, it is about, see, suppose this is the hairline is the problem, and more often in a male it is the receding hairline that is a problem. You put a, it's about 4 centimeters behind, it can be anywhere, right? There's nothing fixed like that, but never anteriorly. The problem with the typical neurosurgical bicoronal flap, when you are emergency sort of situation where you want to access to the skull, people don't think too much about it and put it anteriorly, and then you at the end you repent because your scar is visible. So look at the hairline and you can place it anywhere behind. You can go even up to the posterior occiput and bring it back, bring it forwards. So in a female it's okay, so probably around 4 centimeters from the hairline is okay. And the design can be parallel to this one. So it can be something like this, exactly like that, or it can be zigzag. You can have any type of zigzag like this. The advantage is that the scar is broken already, and then so the chance of alopecia is much less, the scar retraction is much less. But the problem there is that the suturing is much, much more difficult. You have to be spending a lot of time suturing it back. Generally, we tend to put some zigzags now because that is aesthetically better. So, to start with, then after knowing all these things, it's a very, very easy sort of procedure. There's nothing too much to think about it. And mostly, it's an excellent sort of procedure to give you a good access. So, let us be very quick about it. So let's see again, variation has been described that it can go behind the ear, and then you need not go and lift up the ear, you just go and sort of elevate it up so that you know, elevate it up like this, and then you can, not like that, right? Up to this. Leave it. Your incision is like that, still you elevate like that. But classic way is to go pre-triangle. So we'll, and the shaving and all is up to you to do. 2 centimeter shaving or is that? So I'm just making a straight cut. So now the cutting again is important to prevent alopecia. Your cutting has to be in the direction of the hair follicles. Don't cut the hair follicles too much. Transect the hair follicles. So try to make it bit in the line of the hair follicle so that you don't transect it much. There's something called trichophytic closure to prevent that, especially in the hair transplant, you use the trichophytic closure, which has been described for this also, where you trim off a bit of the upper one, you know, the skin. The idea is that when you close it, the hair follicle, what happens is that when you do it like this and close it, the scar, in the area of the scar, transected follicles come, so they don't have hair. So what you do is to take off a strip of hair bearing area in the edge, so that whatever grows will be a non-traumatized hair. That is called trichophytic closure, which can be used for the closure. So now what we do is to, so I have taken care that I am in the line of the follicles. Now what we are going to do is that, see, the layers are very, very easy. So once you go here, you will come to get the subcranial, you know, subgallial sort of plane. I'll try to show you the landmarks rather than concentrate on how we raise it. Again, if you are the right good plane, you don't damage the follicle. See, there is a pericranium, right? I'm leaving it, see here. Now, I'll show you in a minute. You can have another layer if you want later on from the galea. Make sure that you don't damage the hair follicle. It's extremely difficult to take this fascia without damaging the hair follicle. So when you rate, I'll show you the superficial temporal flap. Probably I'll raise it this side and leave this for the temporalis transfer sort of thing. So, yeah. Can we take, or we'll do this side, and then we'll do this side first and then go to the temporalis thing that side. Over, I think it's one of the sides we can. So here, let me be. See, I'm taking the superficial temporal fascia. Now, see, where are we? No, we have inner space, right? Right? So the first point, so this is my flap, this is the deep temporal fascia, and this is the pericranium. So if I am doing a frontal sinus, I'll mark it before and then go up to that and stop and then incise the pericranium and go. Initially, we'll show for the whole pericranial flap for a craniofacial surgery. Once you do this, right? Go for no. You can go. See, unless you release from here, you can go very well down and release it, because that scar behaves well. But don't elevate it here without looking at the nerve. So there, I am. See again. When I do here, the superficial temporal artery will be going in this, right? So I don't think I missed. Right, that's it. Now, let's see. So we have done this much. Now, problem is that unless you raise it from both sides, it won't come yield. But I want to keep it for the other one. Now, let us mark the lateral, this one. Okay, somewhere here. So, I want to incise the fascia so that I won't damage the facial nerve, frontal branch. Bit more down I can go. Once I go there, what I will do is to incise your head. Do you mind if I cut it properly, transect it? It might be easier to show. No, I have not cut it. I wanted to cut it as for a pericranial flap. Now, the vessel starts coming there. Supraorbital ridge has come here, right? So, if I am not using a pericranial, this is mostly elevated. Okay, let's stop here and see what is happening. See, now this is the one. If I am, for a trauma, craniofacial trauma, you have to access the orbit, you have to access the zygoma. Now, the step would be to deal inside the pericranium like that, right? And then go to the bone. Here, again, you would incise the deep temporal fascia, the superficial layer, like this, like that, superficial temporalis muscle, and then you go like that. You will reach the zygoma this way. It is almost like, exactly. Because now the nerve would be safe, and I would reach the zygoma like that. Let us reach it. Knife. Cutting it. Okay. Yeah, this is the zygoma. See, this is my zygoma, right? So, here that fat pad business will come. If I have elevated this much into the under the fascia, and here if I cut it too high, the vessel will be damaged. So, the key would be to look at this line and then keep as low as possible to cut it so that the fat pad's blood supply is not damaged. I have cut it slightly higher up because to make it easy. In a living patient, you would mark that area and then look at it and probably cut just at that level so that you don't damage the vessel that way. And once you do that, your zygoma is exposed here. See, this is the zygoma, right? That's it. So, now the orbit. So, you have gone up to this. There is no structure now here. Nothing to be worried about in the lateral orbital area. So, we can very well cut it because the eye muscles, the frontalis muscle would have been supplied by the nerve, and the eye muscle nerve will be low down here going like that. So you need not worry about it. Now what you do is to go and then here. Go you go along the under the fascia to the orbital periosteum. This is the orbit. This is the orbit, right? Here. Right? So stop here. Now you have incised here. I am going to incise here and come there. But before that, let me show you how we elevate the pericardium. Suppose this is the frontal sinus area, right? You want to do Rave's approach, which Krishna Kumar is going to show. We were doing just, incising it here and elevating it and taking the bone out. Probably we have also become slightly wiser because of the necrosis of this bone. So probably what we would do is to elevate the flap up to this, cut the bone, and make a tunnel here and then cut the bone here in the supraorbital ridge. You can have either superiorly based or inferiorly based. Probably superiorly, inferiorly based is better. But in a, when you want to just do a frontal sinus work for a fracture or anything, you incise here and then lift it off. If you want to do a orbital work, you incise here and lift it off. And if you want to do a typical craniofacial work, I would do a flap like this, whatever you want, and then this will be elevated like that. And this flap will work to close your, give your good lining for your, pardon? No, nothing, bone. I'm elevating with the bone. Here, that is a superficial fascia. That is lateral. No, you need not, you cannot go there. Okay, so this is the way, right? So you take it, I will lift it off like that, and then so you get a very nice layer. So you keep this layer apart and now you do the bony work, right? Whatever you want, you can do. This will cover your entire anterior cranial fossa base. You defect when you do it, you can do that way. Now let us look at the supraorbital and the trochlea. I'm going to cut it here and see the reach of the nerve. Now, so you gently go ahead now, raising it. It should have, see, there is something up. Yeah. No, this is too much. No, that's not too lateral and too much this way high up. It won't be there. It will be in the ridge only. Elevate. You have some. Ah, this is good. Yeah. So that is the root of the nose, right? So I will probably go laterally to be safe and then dissect out that area of our importance, come to that at the end. Slowly go, then you see the vessels coming up. What is it? This is the limit, so probably we should find somewhere here. I'm just cutting to release it, otherwise it's not reaching there. I'll do it on one side because I want to preserve the temporalis for the temporalis flap. Just want to see where the vessel enters, where the nerve bundle. This cut is only for demonstration, not for actual practice, right? Okay, this one. Now, this is the orbital ridge, so we have to be careful here. See if sometimes you know the nerve will travel. No, if there is a notch, it will just go off, right? If there is no bony canal, it will just go down into the orbit. So, it will have gone in here. See, the nerve is coming into this And sometimes what happens is that it is in the trough like that. So it won't go down like that. For that, you will have to just look at that nerve going in and tap that bone which is holding it back. Then it will just go off. Your idea is to lift the, save the nerve and make it go down like that. So if there is no bony trough, it will just go down. And that you will come to know when you keep on elevating, you will come to know that, right? You will find the nerve. Probably this is the one. This is the one. There was something. Not rough, is it? This must be the bundle. This bundle, which must be going this way. But probably then you can push it down. Okay, push it down and get to the orbit. See, I am in the orbit now. There, so I can get it there. Then once you do that, you elevate it up to the zygoma. You are entirely in the orbit is open for you. Okay, and root of the nose, you can go up to the up to the junction of the cartilaginous and bony thing like this. So your exposure is quite adequate. And just looking for the trochlea, which is also not seen in this, which usually you will have seen. Those are the things which will prevent this from maybe this is which prevent this flap from going down. Whatever is preventing it, you can cut it. But the not cut it, lift it down in the bone, in the nerve. You have to tap that bone in the trochlea. You have to just keep to the bone and lift it off. And when you put it back, it stays back, right? No. You can't suture it back. You can't. You're just pulling it back. So this is it will because it. There's no, you cannot suture because it won't hold or it will usually, there's no usually nothing described like that, no issues. So that is okay, right? Now let me go to the other side, temporalis muscle. Let us look at the, so this was the landmark. Now I cannot do it here because I've cut the deep temporal fascia. Let's go here. Can the camera come here? Now what I'm going to show you is the concept behind temporalis flaps. Two clinical situations for using the temporalis flap. There are three flaps, in fact, which can be taken from here. One is a superficial temporal fascia flap. Superficial temporal fascia flap nourished by the superficial temporal artery. It can be dissected out along with the superficial temporal artery and vein, ligated and taken as a free flap for a facial reconstruction. Like a tendo, Achilles or all those places, it's supposed to be very good. You can take a large area. It can be used as a pedicle flap. Mainly now what we use it is for a hemifacial atrophies. Hemifacial atrophies, this is one of the best things to correct the upper deformities. What you do is to take the entire superficial temporal fascia along with the pericranium. So you get a large chunk of tissue, take it down and fill it up. So the advantage is that it doesn't sag down. It is coming from above and it stays there. So that is one. There, when you take the superficial temporal fascia, you have to be careful. You incise. This is not the way you take it. You incise, go underneath the hair follicles, leave a tiny bit of fat there and take this fascia. I'll show you in a minute. I can show you in incisors. See, this is the superficial temporal fascia. So I have to take it at this level. This is my dissection. You can see that I'm not damaging the hair follicles, but I'm leaving a bit of fat there and taking it. And once we take as much as needed. So this is before the elevation. So you have to elevate it, elevate the skin flap, leaving the superficial temporal fascia on the body, and then take it out as a flap. So I can take this flap like that, and then this will be based on the superficial temporal artery. In the second flap which we use is using the entire temporalis muscle as a myofascial flap, where the muscle is covered by the deep temporal fascia. That fascia gives the fascia over that myofascial flap for covering your maxillectomy defects or the infratemporal fossa defects or even a mastoid temporal bone defects. There, the principle is very simple. You incise the entire temporalis muscle like this, and the blood supply of the temporalis is from its deeper aspect, from the deep temporal artery, just above the coronoid process. Okay? So, if you are not damaging it, the artery there, you can use the entire thing, which can be taken and then tunneled to anywhere. Now, to increase the reach, descriptions have been about cutting the coronoid and swinging it out. Mostly, it is very difficult because then you will have to struggle to make sure that the vessel is not damaged. So, mostly what you can do is to just take it off and then you can push it down under the zygoma, over the zygoma, usually under the zygoma into the cheek. The third flap which I am going to show you is the interesting one, is for the facial reanimation, for the temporalis transfer, for the sling, for the facial reanimation. There, what you do is, I can cut it off this. It shows you quite nicely. See, what the best thing for your eye reanimation is temporalis transfer. And for the cheek, you can use the temporalis sling, but it's not very useful. What you do is to you take two strips. This is suppose this is the ear. You make two strips. I am taking a strip of temporalis like this, 2 centimeter strip of temporalis. I will incise this first like that, right? No, I am taking muscle flap with the facial extension. It has to reach the eyelid. So I am going up to the zygoma there. Now, carefully dissecting, you know, incising the thing here like this. Okay? Not the muscle, only the fascia. Incising the muscle. And now I'm going to lift it off from the muscle, from below. I have not detached here. No. Wait till I finish. So, what I'm doing is to take this, because the muscle won't reach otherwise. Right? So, I'm raising it like this. Okay? See, please note that I have not incised here. Right? Now, up to the temporalis crest you can take. Now, what you do is to incise this muscle into the bone. Into the bone like that, deep, okay, and come up and incise here, like this, right? Now, what we do is to elevate the whole thing down. Temporalis, extended by his fascia, the tendon, we are creating a tendon for the temporalis, right? So, now this is your temporalis, right? Now, what you do is to suture it here so that it doesn't tear off with a proline stitch. And now if you look at it, it will reach the eye. Right, it will go underneath. Yeah, because it's, correct. It will. You know, whether it doesn't matter. Fascia as such has been used as a free graft also. But it is attached here, usually it works. It usually works, always it works. So this reaches there, underneath. Now what we do is to make small lateral canthal incision, small incision here, and then this has to be divided into two. Only two, right? Just say about it for me. Spread this way. Okay. I have up to this. Now what we do is to take it underneath. Take it underneath there. Take it to the process. This is over the sagoma, just subcutaneous. Don't be, you have to have it subcutaneous because otherwise you will damage, you see, you won't damage the facial nerve because there is no facial nerve. So that is okay, still it is subcutaneous. See, in this case, yeah, and the pull won't be very good if it is deep. So, this artery. Subcutaneous. Correct. Very good. Now you take it down. And now what happens is that, see, it just goes underneath. So we make a small incision here in the medial canthus and this one, and then tunnel it like this, and then suture it to the medial canthus. So it's a scissor action. It works, right? And close this one. And it has the medially. Subcutaneous tunnel, and in the medial canthus, you have to look for the medial canthal tendon, which is quite visible in always, and then anchor it to the medial canthal tendon, so that it will keep the whole thing down. You will find the medial canthal tendon very easily with a small incision. So everything is subcutaneous, and if you want, you can use another strip of temporalis like this and take it to the cheek. Okay. With the muscle. One strip. No, one strip goes to the upper lid, one strip goes to the lower lid. It's a scissor action. It closes like that. And then the patient is advised to learn to close the eye by clenching the teeth. 3 months. 3 months. 2 to 3 months. You may need to, your tension has to be just adequate. You know, just make sure that it closes. And don't tighten it too much. Because you can go back and make a small incision here and tighten it later on if you want. With a small, under local anesthesia. If you tighten it too much, it's very difficult to loosen it later on. No. Muscle should be here only. Usually when you do it, exactly like what I said, it will just reach. You will have some 1 centimeter extra of this fascia, that's all. It will be just sitting there. In the cheek also, in the subcutaneous layer, subdermal, proline. Structure is the, it's really the muscle. It's a subdermal, it is between the dermis and the subcutaneous tissue. So that there is a pull, and then you can have the fold forming. So you mark the nasolabial fold, go just beyond that. So when it pulls, the fold forms. It is not very good for the cheek. It doesn't work brilliantly. Some people it works. Because it's a cheek. But see, the problem is the cheek, this is only one pull this way. So probably it might not do. Yeah? Vector works only in the upper part, upper way. Not always. And then it's not always, it doesn't work very well. But for eye, it works. 99% you can give a reasonable good result. Probably you may need tightening, 1 or 2 tightening more. Mostly it works. And sheer weight of it also helps a bit. And then surprisingly, people say that their eye closure is quite good. Even, you know, blinking also becomes good. And your gold implant, so if our policy for a facial palsy is that you look at what is the cause of the facial palsy. If the facial palsy is going to be temporary, like a skull-based tumor where the nerve has been delineated and made, it's a continuous, there you put the gold weight and wait for about 8 to 9 months and then do it. In a case of a transection of the facial nerve, you have 2 choices. One is that if the patient is mentally prepared and the patient has been told about these things, you can go ahead with the temporalis transfer immediately. There's nothing to prevent you from that. Otherwise, put a gold weight immediately and then prepare the patient again and then bring back for a temporary transfer. We would prefer to do a temporary transfer in a permanent thing. Far better, because the lower lid laxity also is taken care by this one. The other one, gold weight, just covers that one. The lower lid become, over the period of years and years, that is also a big problem. The lower lid laxity and the watering is a big problem. Yeah, then if it is a transection, and you have, as we said, that you have a branch and then the main trunk, you put a cable graft, then it takes about 8 to 9 months for that to recover. In that case, you can put a gold weight as a temporary one. Anything which is recoverable, you put a gold weight. Which one? Yeah, for temporalis transfer, you just put a zigzag incision. Yeah, and you just go to the deep temporal fascia. Preauricular. You need not even go below the hairline. You just need to start somewhere in the top here and then go. Because the rest of it can be tunnel. And the good thing here is that there's no facial nerve, so you're not bothered about the frontal branch. You can tunnel it without any problem. Yeah. See, masseter and the masseter is a. We have been using it, but it's not very, very good. You can use it simultaneously, but it's nothing which prevents you from using a masseter. Masseter transfer would be, you just give an incision here and then go up to the periosteum, elevate the masseter, and then shift it anteriorly with some facial extension. So you can do it simultaneously. No. Masseter to this, because it won't reach like that. And then cross.